and Jesus lives in us. Now at this point, Jesus again changes gears a little bit and says, "Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour." And here we learn just how human Jesus is. He was anxious. He was torn up inside. He knew the agony of the cross that awaited him. And he asks God that he might be delivered from it. But then, rather than panicking, he lives in obedience to God the Father, and he resolves to do the very thing that he was sent to earth to do, die on the cross for the sins of the whole world. Then Jesus asks that God would glorify his name. And the voice booms from heaven saying, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." Now Jesus knew what the voice was saying. Others thought it was thunder. Some thought it was an angel. Now when a voice booms from heaven, that means something significant has happened. Three times in Jesus' ministry in the Gospels, we read of a voice, God's voice, that booms from heaven. One at Jesus' baptism, another at Jesus' transfiguration, and then the last one is here at the onset of Jesus' death. Now there's some gut-wrenching, beautiful irony happening here with this message from God from the sky. Now, you wouldn't think that these two adjectives, gut-wrenching and beautiful, belong together. But for the Christian, they really do. The fact is, God is glorified. His name is glorified. He is praised, no more so than when Jesus hung on the cross. Now, the cross to the world, the cross to unbelievers is a great embarrassment, isn't it? But for believers, the cross is gut-wrenching. Because we know that Jesus was cruelly treated for our sins. Our sins put him there, and that's gut-wrenching. But at the same time, the cross is also beautiful, because that's where Jesus won the forgiveness of sins and eternal life. God was glorified when Jesus obediently went to the cross. Because there at the cross, God's love, his nature, was put on display for the whole world. His love and passion to see people saved. After God's voice booms from heaven, Jesus teaches his listeners some more about what his impending death means. It means the judgment of the world and its ruler. Jesus says, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out." Now Jesus uses the word world here to refer to human society in rebellion to its creator. Now if you think about that, that has been happening since Adam and Eve ate the fruit. The world, people, have been in rebellion to God. Now, there's always been a remnant, sinners chosen by God and faithful to him. Noah, Abraham, David, the prophets, Christians. But those outside of the faith, those who reject the gospel, do nothing to please God. And Jesus' death means that the world has been judged essentially. All people who die as unbelievers have been judged. And when Jesus comes back, he could say that that's just the sentencing. And the sentence, of course, for unbelief is eternal torment. There's more irony going on here because the very ones who killed Jesus feel that they are passing judgment on him. They feel that they are passing judgment on him as a charlatan, as a blasphemer. But really, it's the other way around. This is is how one person puts it. By killing Jesus, the world pronounced its own death sentence and lost its right to exist. Now, it's not just the world that has been judged at Jesus' death. It's also the ruler of this world. Jesus says, now will the ruler of this world be cast out. So who is the ruler of this world? It's the devil, Satan, our great ancient enemy. That powerful spirit who deceived Adam and Eve into sin and who has deceived every human being since then into all manner of sins. But at Jesus' death, the very time and place where Satan thought he had achieved his greatest victory, his greatest coup yet, was the very time and place where he met his doom. Jesus says Satan will be cast out. But this is the language of exorcism. This is the language of great and ultimate defeat. But it's not a demon, as we see in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. This is an exorcism of the chief of the demons. This is an exorcism of Satan himself. So what does it mean that Satan is cast out? Well, first of all, it means good news. It means good news indeed, because as believers, this means that Satan is no longer your master. He is no longer the head honcho. So the next time he comes to you and tries to trip you up, you can say, be gone, Satan. I'm a slave of Christ now. The scripture says he will flee from you because you've resisted him. Now some of you might ask, well, if Satan is defeated, why do I still see him active in the world, deceiving people and causing them to sin, to murder, to commit adultery, to lie, to covet, to steal? That's a valid question. Part of the answer is this, that Satan might be exercising some dominance out there. But in the true church, the body of believers, where there is confession, where there is absolution, where God's pure word is preached, and where the sacraments of baptism and Holy Communion are celebrated, that's where life and salvation are. So Satan is not there. Another part of the answer is Satan is losing dominance all the time. He's losing ground all the time because God's church is being built all over the world. Disciples are being made all over the world from every language, people, and nation. And the gates of hell are not prevailing against it. And yet another part of the answer is this. Satan knows his time is short. And soon, very soon, when Jesus comes back, Satan will be locked up into the lake of fire forever and ever. And for us believers, this means no more torment, no more suffering, no more sin. Just paradise with God forever and ever. After Jesus speaks about the judgment of the world and the casting out of our old enemy Satan, he then says, when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself. Now when Jesus says he is lifted up from the earth, he means really two things. He means being lifted up on the cross. He also means being lifted up as in being exalted, as in being glorified. This is the means, this is the only means that we are all saved from our sins. That is the means by which, through faith, we pass from condemnation into eternal life. This is the means by which people from everywhere are going to be saved by grace through faith for Christ's sake. Because Jesus died on the cross for the whole world's sins. So Jesus' death, his resurrection, his exaltation mean everything for us. We learn in our text today that It means eternal life, because Jesus' death, like a grain of wheat that dies, means eternal life for the rest of us. Jesus' death also means salvation, salvation from judgment, salvation from sin, and salvation from the author of sin, Satan himself.